There are two Gree DC inverter PCBs that have come in for repair. Looking at the first PCB, its switching IC is completely burned out. Similarly, examining the second PCB, its switching IC appears to be perfectly fine. However, someone has already attempted to repair it, and the capacitor has been replaced, yet the PCB is still not functioning properly. The reason for this is that its fuse keeps blowing repeatedly. Additionally, some wires have been connected to test it. Now, looking at the second PCB, its surface appears completely clean, meaning no visible repair work has been done on it. However, upon closer inspection, the capacitor is swollen. The question arises, what mistake did the previous technician make that prevented this PCB from being repaired successfully? Physically, the first PCB has clear issues, its capacitor is swollen, and the switching IC is broken. These are the obvious visible faults. On the other hand, the second PCB does not show any physical damage. It appears to be in good condition, which is why only the capacitor was replaced. However, after replacing the capacitor and bypassing the fuse with a wire, the fuse blew again when the PCB was powered on. So, the first mistake here was assuming that simply replacing the capacitor would fix the PCB. Other components must also be checked, because if they are not, the same issue will keep occurring. In this case, the technician replaced the capacitor, but did not replace the bridge rectifier. Now, let's check the bridge rectifier using a multimeter in diode mode. When placing the positive probe on the positive terminal and the negative probe on the negative terminal, the reading shows zero. Checking the next point also shows zero, confirming that the bridge rectifier is shorted. However, replacing only the bridge rectifier will not eliminate the short circuit. The switching IC also needs to be replaced. Looking at the drain pin, we see that it appears blackened, indicating some damage has occurred. Now, if the drain pin were not blackened, how would we determine if the switching IC is faulty? One way is to test it using a multimeter in diode mode. However, this is not always a foolproof method, because sometimes the IC appears fine on the meter, but does not function properly in the circuit. Still, this method helps determine whether the short circuit is present inside the switching IC or elsewhere. For example, if we install a new bridge rectifier to replace the shorted one, but the switching IC is still shorted, the new bridge rectifier will short again. This process will keep repeating, causing continuous failures. In some cases, this can also damage the chopper transformer or other nearby components in the circuit. To avoid this issue, it is crucial to check all components thoroughly before powering on the PCB. Any component showing signs of a short circuit must be replaced before testing to prevent further damage. First, we need to check the switching IC, along with the diode and other surrounding components. This will help determine whether there is a short circuit in this area or not. To do this, we will attach the multimeter probes. Place the multimeter probes on the source and drain terminals of the switching IC. Also, check the MOSFET connected to it. If the MOSFET is shorted, it can cause the bridge rectifier to short as well. Now, if you place one probe on any terminal and the other on the drain, and it shows zero voltage drop, this confirms the IC is faulty. However, sometimes the meter will display a voltage drop instead of a zero reading, but if all terminals show zero, the component is clearly shorted and must be replaced. In some cases, the switching IC may test fine using a multimeter, but still fail to function properly when powered on. In such situations, replacing it is necessary, as it might be internally faulty despite showing correct readings on the meter. Now, we will proceed with replacing the faulty components on both PCBs. One PCB already has a burnt IC, and the other one is completely dead, so we will replace the switching ICs on both boards. While the soldering iron is heating up, we can check the ZNR using the ohms mode on the multimeter. Upon testing, it shows 33.6 ohms, which could indicate a fault. Since the ZNR is connected to multiple points, including the bridge rectifier, it might be contributing to the short circuit. So, what we do first is remove all the faulty components from the circuit. After that, we will check whether the installed ZNR shows the correct reading. I have desoldered the bridge rectifier from the circuit. Now, I will also remove this capacitor from the circuit. I am heating its pins from the top, while I have pulled out the capacitor from the bottom. Now, in the same way, I will also remove this IC from here, but I will cut it. I have removed it. Now, we will check the ZNR again. It is showing a resistance value in mega ohms, whereas it should not show any value. This means it is also faulty. I will remove it from the circuit as well. I am heating each pin one by one, and now the ZNR has also been removed from the circuit. However, when tested outside the circuit, the ZNR appeared to be completely fine, meaning the issue might be elsewhere in the circuit. To investigate further, we check the ZNR points on the PCB and it showed resistance value in megaohms. Following the circuit traces, we measured resistance at different points, including after the line and neutral, and found some values, suggesting a possible fault. To confirm if there was any short circuit, we switched to continuity mode, as a fault would cause the multimeter to beep. So look at this. There is no beep sound at all. Additionally, some capacitors and a PTC sensor were present in this section, which might be affecting the readings. So, let's check this PTC sensor in continuity mode. There is no beep at all, so there is a chance that the PCB might be okay up to this point. We will clean the points where the switching IC was installed. The switching IC number is TNY278PN. Now we can use one of the two ICs available. The original IC is also in my hand, but we can also use TNY279PN. The difference between the two is in wattage, but their function is the same. The original capacitor on the PCB is 47 microfarad for 50 volts, while the replacement capacitor we are using is 33 microfarad for 50 volts. If the microfarad value is slightly higher or lower, it doesn't make much difference. You can also use a capacitor with a slightly higher voltage rating, or the same as the original. However, if you use a capacitor with a lower voltage rating, it will likely fail or swell up quickly. And while installing the electrolytic capacitor, you must be very careful about its positive and negative polarity. If it is installed incorrectly, even by mistake, it will immediately blast. I have this bridge rectifier available, so I will install it. This rectifier was in a DIP package, but I have modified it into an SMD by bending all four legs. Now it will function just like an SMD component. While installing it, the positive and negative pins must be placed accurately, because if it is installed incorrectly, it will burst immediately. It has been installed on the circuit. At this stage, we are not installing the ZNR temporarily. Instead, we will test the PCB without the ZNR to check its functionality before finalizing the repair. And later, we will reinstall this protection device. Before powering it on again, I will definitely check the MOSFET of the switching IC to ensure there is no short circuit. To do this, I will measure the voltage drop between its two key points. The multimeter shows a voltage drop of 0.508 volts, indicating that the MOSFET is in good condition and there is no short circuit present. This confirms that it is safe to apply power to the PCB. Now, after supplying electricity, the indoor unit successfully turns on without any issues. This demonstrates that the repair was successful, but it is important to remember that proper testing is crucial to ensure all faults are eliminated before reassembling the unit. Now, for the second PCB, we will replace the three main components directly without performing additional tests. I will pull it off. I have removed the capacitor. If we encounter a situation where the switching IC is burnt, it is crucial to check the nearby diode. If the diode is shorted, the issue can reoccur even after replacing the IC. So, I will definitely test it. Look at this. It is completely fine. This means that only three components needed to be replaced. The ZNR should show the same value as before. I will set the multimeter to resistance mode. Here, the ZNR is showing the same resistance value in megaohms, which means it is okay. The ZNR was fine even in the other circuit board earlier. Now that the second PCB is ready, I applied power to test it. However, the display did not turn on, indicating that there is still another issue in this PCB. Off camera, I performed detailed checks, but did not find any short circuits or faulty components. Next, I rechecked the soldering of all the replaced components. Switching IC, its soldering looked perfect. Capacitor, the soldering was also properly done. Bridge rectifier, at first glance, the soldering looked fine from the top view, but this point looks like it has been soldered, yet the solder hasn't properly adhered to the pad. The other three pins are fine. I will redo the soldering properly. I had previously tried to solder it well, but there was still a fault left. Sometimes this can happen. Now I will solder it properly. Now it has been soldered properly. Now we will test both circuit boards together to check whether they are working or not. I am supplying power to them. The display is showing 30 degrees, which means it is okay. The other board is showing F1 error, because the thermistors are not installed. In contrast, the first board has thermistors installed. This confirms that both boards have been successfully repaired. Click on the left or right thumbnail to watch our next videos, and subscribe. Thank you.